Hello, Jessica Bruders. Thank you for being here for the Romanian readers. And welcome
Hi,
to
Alia.
virtual Romania, as to say. So I'm very, very happy to read your book in Romanian. And I have to admit that, of course, I saw the movie Nomadland twice, and I read your book twice. And I have to admit the fact that I love more the book than the movie, but I also love the movie. So congratulations for both of them.
Thank you very much.
And before talking about the book, because most of the Romanian readers, I'm sure they saw the movie because it's an extraordinary movie, I would like you to tell them a few words about your experience about with this movie, with the actors. And we already know that not all the characters in the movie are actors, but real characters in real life. What this all meant for you?
Yeah, well, it was an incredible and very unusual experience in that as a nonfiction author with a lot of friends who also write nonfiction books, I know many people who are accustomed to getting a little bit of interest from Hollywood and then nothing happens. So I kept myself on what I called a steady diet of low expectations when there was interest originally expressed a few months after the book came out in the US. And lo and behold, it all started happening pretty quickly. And for me, the most exciting part was watching the film incorporate so many people that I'd been following at that point for, gosh, 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
Who I had just made this commitment to as a reporter, and suddenly they were getting to express themselves in a completely different venue at a point in their lives. I mean, many of them are 60 plus, and at least in the US, I think a lot of people just get this idea that you've done whatever you're going to do when you're in that later third of life. So to see that A, disproved, and to see these people just get validated for sharing their experiences was absolutely wonderful for me and a real adventure.
I'm thinking right now about Linda and what all this meant to her. I mean, from a nomad life, living in a small van and just being on an Oscar carpet, it's so huge. It's like, I don't know, the best day of your life. Was she impressed?
Yeah, but it's funny. Linda is Linda no matter what situation you put her in, which for me as a journalist, and you know this, often when we're interviewing people, they go into interview mode. So, you know, you're interviewing me and I'm trying to be the good interview subject and tell you what I think people might want to know. But what I loved about Linda for the kind of work I do is that she was the same whether I was recording a conversation with her or she was in a grocery store or she was at work. Because as an immersion reporter, I followed her around a lot. And I felt like that really transferred both to film and to the glitz of Hollywood, where Linda enjoyed the ride. She has a sense of herself that I don't think shifted radically. I mean, she was thrilled with everything that happened. But by the same token, she just has this wonderfully grounded attitude. And she's very open to life. She once said that her mother told her, if you're invited to a party, you should say yes. And I kind of feel like that's how she approached the entire process.
I mean, she is a lovely person. I have to say that. But for the Romanian readers, your future Romanian readers, we should say that. Okay, they know the movie Nomadland, but there is a book which inspired this movie, who won 3 Oscars, but the book is called Nomadland, Surviving America in the 21st Century, and it was translated into Romanian. The name in Romanian is Ținutul Nomazilor at Trei Publishing House, which means Editura Trei. So when I first read the book, I told you I read the book twice. I thought, what a beautiful and exquisite and extraordinary journal. And then I said, no, it's not a journal, it's journalism. And then I said, no, it's not journalism, it's top journalism. and you are a journalist. No, really, the work you did writing this book, really, I'm a journalist. I mean, the work you did, it's so huge. The information in the book in Romanian has, I don't know, 400 pages, but the information inside is so huge. How did you manage to do all this huge project?
Well, there were definitely many times that I thought the whole thing might fall apart, to be honest. Things that might look very smooth when we see them in the rearview mirror don't always feel that way in the moment. Nomadland, the book that turned into the movie, started as a magazine story for an American magazine called Harper's. And I had never written for this magazine before. When I initially approached them about the story, the characters were entirely different. The thing about this sort of immersion journalism is you can make all the plans you want, but when you get out into the real world and you're spending all this time following people, there are so many things that will happen that you can't anticipate. I never imagined meeting Linda. I never imagined that I'd follow her for 3 years. So for me, after the magazine story came out and it ran on the cover and it got a fair amount of attention, and I started talking to an editor about developing it into a book, the big thing was really just to get out on the road. Humans are very adaptive creatures, which is good and bad. We actually, I think, get blind to things that we're immersed in, which is, you know, not to editorialize, but a reason we haven't done much about climate change, right? We adapt to things so quickly that often we kind of can't see outside the present moment. So for me, I would spend, you know, maybe 2 months on the road and then come back to New York in an effort to just kind of recalibrate and see things from that outside perspective. But the whole project took about 3 years. It was the hardest thing I've ever done, and I don't regret a moment of it.
I mean, we should tell the people who are watching this that it was more than you said, because, okay, so let's have a resume. Your journey spanned more than 15,000 miles, which in Romanian means 24,000 kilometers, just to understand where we stand. And you did that driving a van, a white GMC Vandura you named Helen. And your intention was to meet, okay, nomads who were, roaming the American West, people who live in vans, cars, or RVs. And I want you to tell that in Romania, we don't have this culture of living in an RV. For most of the people I know, they say, oh, it's so much fun going on a trip, on a van. It's so much fun. No, it's not about fun. It's about fun when you have a house. But these people are houseless people. And I like this word, and you pointed it out in the book, and it's in the movie. Who are these houseless people and not homeless people?
Yeah, a lot of the people I met had adopted the word houseless rather than homeless as a way to assert their dignity and agency. And just in the US, the word homeless, it's practically a dirty word. It's practically an insult. People hear that word and they think of other people. They don't think about complex lives and stories. So by saying I'm houseless, but I have a home, I have shelter and transportation, it's a way that these people ask us to think a little bit more about them and not to have prejudice or jump to conclusions. A lot of the people I met were part of a subculture, and they refer to themselves as work campers. So many of these people were at or nearing what used to be retirement age in the US. But wages here are flat, or had been until recently. It's changing a bit. The price of housing keeps going up. We still are in a housing catastrophe in the US, and retirement finance is a mess. And a lot of people who got wiped out in the market crash in 2008 didn't have time to recover. And there's this whole, again, subculture of people who are traveling the country from job to job, everything from working in Amazon warehouses to maintaining campgrounds to helping with the annual sugar beet harvest. And these were the people that I went out to follow. But like many people in Romania, I initially thought of an RV. I said, okay, that stands for recreational vehicle. And my perspective was limited to people who were going out for recreation and then coming back home. And learning a bit more really opened my eyes to things that I didn't know were going on, essentially in my own backyard.
Actually, all these people you are talking about are an inspiration for all of us because they are not hopeless. I mean, every time I read about them in the book, I had the impression that I am more hopeless than them, even if I have a house of my own. I mean, I don't even have the sense of what it really means freedom, what it really means being protected. I lost all those senses. And your characters, who are real people, know better what means freedom. What did you find out about freedom knowing all these beautiful people?
Oh, freedom is such a tricky word because I think in America, at least, it gets abused a lot, right? Mm-hmm. Like in the present moment when we're dealing with a pandemic, we have a lot of people claiming that freedom means they shouldn't have to think of the community at all, which means not wearing a mask. So I think for a lot of
same
people,
here. Same here.
Freedom becomes, for a lot of people, the ability to do whatever you want, which isn't a very nuanced look at the system. For the people I met, I think a lot of people look at them from the outside as failures or down and outers, when the truth is the failure is our system, our housing system, our economy, and the fact that these people who are incredibly creative and resilient couldn't really put together a good life within that system. And because they were brave and creative, they decided to try something new. And because they were feeling oppressed by the traditional system, they found something that felt, in comparison, like freedom. But it took a lot of courage. And that was very inspiring to me also, because I think as a culture, we think it's so hard to shift things. You know, like we can't do better. It's so hard. And if you think about people who, again, in their 60s are completely changing how they live so radically. And then when we talk about incremental changes in our lives to make positive social change, to make things better with the environment, we're kind of pathetic compared to these people who so radically reimagine how they would live and are having a good go of it.
Yeah, actually, I was thinking right now, forget everything you know about nomad life, because what you thought it was a nomad life is not. Because I had to, I don't know, I thought some things about nomad people in America, but no, this is not the point. Actually, we are talking about the 2008 financial collapse when people lost their houses. We have to understand this. And they didn't have a choice to embrace this culture, because it is a culture. The nomad life in America is a culture, I think, and I think you agree. Mm-hmm. And they didn't have a choice. We had a similar situation in Romania. I would like our Romanian followers to understand when, for instance, little cities or towns as Moldovano or Uricani or Mioveni just suffered because the factories out there were ruined, just because of the financial collapse, and people were had to leave the country just to work as, I don't know, mushroom collectors or etc. I don't know. But from this point of view, if you read this book, you might say that, okay, capitalism does wrong. But what was your main purpose? What do you want the reader to understand from this particular point of view?
Yeah, you know, a lot of my favorite writing isn't the kind of manifesto writing. So my goal in the book mm-hmm. is never to tell readers, I want you to think this way and you're an idiot if you don't. My goal is to help people think about a more complicated world than the one mm-hmm. that they might be hearing from at a distance. So some of the goals are very simple. I mean, if people, and I have gotten emails from people who said, I read the book And, you know, there's somebody I pass who lives in a van every day. And I always assumed that that person, you know, people assume bad things, that this person was some sort of loser or had screwed up. And it just, it asks people to slow down and reconsider the people around us and the systems around us, and to appreciate the complexity in all of us. So while I do believe the book questions aspects of capitalism, it's not in a manifesto way. I mean, if you ask me personally, I will tell you that I think markets are really good tools for societies, but terrible masters. You know, elements of capitalism are great, but it's a matter of, we need to have a market that serves the society rather than a society that's really tethered to a market, if that makes any sense.
Yes, it makes very much sense. I would like to talk about Amazon City, because it is a huge chapter in your book, and I really loved it, if I can say that, loved it. I was sad a little, but because I never imagined that, I don't know, when you receive at your step door a lipstick, a book, I don't know, a kitchen robot, anything. I never imagined the work within Amazon and the lives that hide behind Amazon City. I never knew what this meant. So when I saw the movie Nomadland, well, we had a small image of Amazon City, but not the whole image. In the book, you have the whole image. Please tell us more about this Amazon City and your experience with Amazon City and the stories of these people who are working there as a seasonal work, which is hard, but very hard work.
Yeah, so believe it or not, learning about these Amazon towns, that was what got me on the road to writing the book, was finding out about these. There was an article I read in a magazine. The writer's a fantastic journalist named Gabe McClelland, writing for Mother Jones, and it was a story about working in warehouses. And one person approached the reporter and said, yeah, you know, I'm working here. I live full-time in an RV. I do this job because I can't afford to retire. And there's a whole program for people like us. And those last words lit my hair on fire, basically. You know, the article just went back to the warehouse and my hair is on fire. And I'm thinking, wait a minute. One of the most quote-unquote successful companies on the planet has a dedicated program that essentially amounts to geriatric migrant labor. What? Like, this doesn't make any sense to me. So I started digging into what I learned was called Camper Force, which is a very kind of catchy named program. They have a logo with a smiling RV, and gosh, I can't go through the boxes right now, but I have a whole collection of their kind of propaganda and paraphernalia, from t-shirts to lipstick, I mean, lip balm, sorry, chapstick. They make everything to promote it. And they travel around the country recruiting RVers, and these are typically older RVers, to do seasonal work in Amazon warehouses. And as we know, that work is very physically grueling, particularly for older people. So when I was first researching the book, I went to the town of Fernley, Nevada, actually to an RV park called the Desert Rose, which is featured heavily in the movie, which is very surreal for me because I spent a lot of time there. And, you know, people were commuting to do some pretty hard work in this warehouse. And the program still exists. I think when I stopped reporting on it, Amazon had it in maybe 5 locations. And now, gosh, it's a dozen or 2 dozen. It's only been expanding as Amazon gets larger.
I will read an excerpt from your book, from the chapter with Amazon City. There's a woman out there working, and she has a lot of humor, really. But she writes, you have a cart with 14 tubs of Chinese junk. You said, she told me, one of the depressing parts was I knew all this stuff was going to end up in a landfill. You think about all the resources it took to get it there. And then it's use it up, throw it away. We all do that. Was it hard for you to understand these people who are practically, they were thinking at one point, what am I working for? A few money, which doesn't help me even to, I don't know, for I don't know, something wrong with my engine for the RV. It was so few money.
Yeah, and it was interesting because that quote that you just shared, that was something Linda May said to me. And she said it after several years of doing this. And I watched her thinking evolve the more time she spent on this job, getting frustrated with it. And I saw this attitude among other people too, the idea that what is wrong with our society? We spend our lives working very, very hard until we die to make some money, but also to go into debt buying things we don't need to impress people we don't really care about. And then we throw them away. And just what a strange existence is that. So when she started speaking that way, I also knew it was the last time she'd be working there.
She was climbing and descending stairs, all while traversing a warehouse roughly the size of 13 football fields, which is huge. Who does that? We do Zoom nowadays. Come on.
Yeah, no, I knew a gentleman in his 70s who brought a just a step tracker in and found out that he sometimes was walking 15 miles a day on these concrete floors, which is hard on, you know, it's hard on your joints and body, even if you're not in your 70s.
What did really overwhelm you, really, in all this work of all these people?
Oh, gosh, everything. I was incredibly impressed by them. I was daunted by the responsibility of sharing their stories and doing my best to get it right. And just by being out there and frankly, their generosity with their stories was overwhelming to me. I remember coming back home and somebody said, okay, you're a woman doing this by yourself on the road all the time and it's a dangerous world. And did you have a gun or do you know Kung Fu? And they seemed incredibly disappointed when I told them that not only had I not encountered any immediate danger, but I felt so disappointing that I would tell them, but there was one problem, and they would lean in and I would say, caloric hazard, because everybody tried to feed me too much. And I was afraid I would gain all kinds of weight. No, I mean, there was incredible hospitality. So it might sound cliche, but meeting all these people who were so generous with what they know and with what they had, and were also just living under so many constraints compared to many other people, that was something that really just bowled me over emotionally. I was really impressed and felt like I learned a lot about people and what they're capable of.
I would have never done what you did. So again, congratulations. I mean,
I've never done what they did. So
no, you're the perfect journalist, really. You know, I wanted to say that at the end, but I'm going to tell it now. You know, we have in Romania two extraordinary journalists who live in an RV. So they left everything behind and they are two journalists who actually travel across Europe and make top journalism about Romanian people, leaving Romania just to work outside for a better living, etc. Their names are Elena Stancu and Cosmin Bumbuț, and their project is called At Home on the Road. I mean, if you met them, you would just love them. They are perfect. And what they do, I mean, it's a choice. I mean, you just can't live in an RV all your life by, I don't know, just imagining that one day you will have some luck to survive. They are working a lot. And I would like you to ask this question. From all these people you met, did they tell you for once that this was their choice?
Yeah, so a lot of people did say that. So when I first met people, they would tell me about how they were going on a great adventure and how they'd chosen to do this and wasn't it amazing? And I think for part of it, that might be why journalists in the US had kind of missed the story before, because sometimes to get a real story, you have to spend a lot of time with people, because first they tell you the thing that's easy to talk about or the thing that they feel you might want to hear. And then if you go away, you never learn anything else, right? So often with the people I met, when I'd been there a few days, they would tell me about, the mortgage going underwater, losing the house, the divorce, the medical debt, just all of the challenges that had led them to what they still considered a decision. Because, you know, maybe you could go live in a homeless shelter, maybe you could live on the street. So people did not, people weren't, you know, intentionally lying to me or something like that. And what I realized I had to reconsider was, what do I think of as choice? Because for these people, it was very important that it was a choice, because it was a way they were saying, I'm not a victim, I'm going to find a way to make this work. So I never wanted to tell anybody, oh, you were forced into this, because while their circumstances definitely cut out many, many options, they also had some agency in deciding how to make things work in their lives. And I think that sort of agency is part of dignity. So out of respect for them, I started just thinking about, okay, what might look like no choice to me might very validly feel like a choice internally for the people I'm talking to. And I can talk about that and I can share that without, you know, dismissing them and just saying, oh, they're wrong, they're in denial.
You know, I told you at the beginning that I loved more your book than the movie. And I think it's normal, because if you read the book, you find out more about the characters you just loved in the movie. Not all the characters in the movie are in your book. The movie is part fiction, of course. But I would like to talk more about these characters I love so much. I mean, Linda May or Don Wheeler, who is a mysterious character. He didn't even want to mention his real name. Or, and this I love, where is this? Swanky Wills. Oh, she's lovely. Or Iris Goldberg, or Ghost Dancer. Also a mysterious character and very funny and all. How were for you all these people? Please tell us more about these characters, about who we know very little from the movie, but we want to know more and more.
The guy I called Don Wheeler, who when I interviewed him was afraid of getting fired, after the book came out, was very proud of his contribution. And I think he if we could go back in time, he would use his real name.
His
name is Jerry. I can tell you he's Jerry, and he's great. But yeah, when I first met Swanky, so Swanky, there's an interesting backstory. Mm-hmm. I was heading out in the camper van, and I had no idea where I was going to stay. I was just starting to transition from the magazine story to the book, and Swanky welcomed me into her camp in Quartzsite, Arizona, and she was there, and you know, Swanky was in her 70s, and she was mentoring this young trans man, Vincent, who was new to the road, helping Vincent install solar panels and just get used to his life, and also accepting, letting Vincent use her post office box to receive testosterone shots in the mail. Now, keep in mind, Swanky didn't grow up in a world that was very LGBTQ friendly. So the fact that she had expanded her own degree of acceptance and understanding was just really amazing to watch. Also at that point, her family, she had fallen out with her family and they wouldn't even accept her mail at their house, which is why she had the post office box. So seeing her embrace and create this unusual kind of new family on the road that expanded her way of being in the world, I thought was just fantastic. And again, we have so many thoughts about how people get more stiff as they get older and their worlds get smaller. And again, we're all getting older. We're all on the same conveyor belt, right? And seeing Swanky continue to update herself and challenge herself and expand her world, it was really exciting to me. And I think it should be exciting to all of us who aren't in our 70s just yet.
Linda, she is so very important for the journey, for your journey and for the book. And she's quite a woman. I mean, she's living in the squeeze in, and she's very funny because she said if visitors don't get the name on first mention, she puts it in a sentence. Yeah, there's the room, squeeze in. So she's very, very funny, and she smiles at the end. And she has a dream. Actually, you followed her dream just going out there at the frontier of Mexico, I guess, 9 miles.
Arizona. Yes. Arizona, near the Mexican
just
border.
Just to see her future dream happening in the Chihuahuan desert, just to build a special house. What's this special house, which actually looks like something galactic or I don't know, future like?
Yeah, she had a dream of building something called an Earthship, and yeah. This house, yeah, that's built, it's off the grid, it relies on solar energy and also passive solar energy. So for example, the back of it is made of tires stuffed with building material, and they absorb heat during the day and they radiate it at night. So it's made out of all used materials and recycled materials. And the idea is it kind of becomes a self-sustaining organism. It helps control its own climate. You can grow food in it. And she was fascinated with this idea. It was popular in the US in the 70s. I think there was a movie on it. And Linda had been a general contractor. So this was her dream. And the fact that she had this interesting dream, you know, we're journalists, we're looking for a through line. We're looking for somebody mm-hmm. facing a challenge sometimes to follow. Yeah. And the fact that she was so incredibly open to me and so unselfconscious just really made her such a wonderful person to spend time with as a journalist.
What's happening right now? Did she begin to, I don't know, build something out there? Because the last time you were there in the book, it was nothing. It was like hell, nothing.
It was rough. And so it got rougher before it got better. I went out there with my best friend because Linda was building a giant greenhouse with plastic PVC pipes. And we helped her put the plastic sheet over it. And once she was away and the whole thing melted, those plastic pipes looked like spaghetti. They look like noodles. It was terrible. Okay. Linda ended up buying another piece of land. So the great thing about Hollywood coming to town was, you know, as journalists, people aren't getting a salary for letting us hang out or talk to them. But when you're working in a movie, it's a different thing, right? I mean, they have actual budgets. It's kind of radical. And so Linda was able to buy a piece of land in Taos, New Mexico. And basically, her dream changed. So like all of us, Linda was getting older. Linda really dreamed not only of the Earthship, but of having something to leave behind to her grandchildren and a way to share hospitality with the people she loves. So her dream completely changed. She is now actually working on a fixer-upper house. It's a little closer to her family. I can't give extreme details on it because Linda has also decided to drop out of the public eye, which I completely respect. But, you know, one of the biggest questions I always get is, did Linda build her Earthship? I was just in Poland, where the book has been released, and a woman ran up to me and asked me in Polish if Linda had built her Earthship. And I was so touched by that. I had to tell Linda. Of course, I needed it translated. But I'm just happy that Linda's happy. And I think for a while, she felt a little guilty because everybody was saying, oh, Linda's got to build the Earthship. And you know, Linda's doing her own kind of homesteading now. It's what she wants, and she's happy. And for me, that means the world. Just following her journey has been incredible, and seeing it come to this place is great.
It's all that counts, that she's happy. I adore her, really. If you have the chance to tell her, I adore her. She has one reader who adores her. So Bob Wells is also a character I love a lot. He's like a guru, I don't know, but a perfect guru for human wisdom. I mean, sometimes I thought while reading your book that he has more wisdom than all those people talking on, I don't know, YouTube and so on, who are talking to us from saying that, and saying that, oh, we are so happy, happiness can be found, blah, blah, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So this guy is really, really inspirational, I might say. So he's an inspiration for everybody. And actually, he's the one who wrote in his book about how the life in the first day in an RV. And he said that, no, it's not what you expect. It's horror. And he says, and you may not get much sleep. When you wake up in the morning, you will be disoriented and wonder where you are. It's what happened to you while living in an RV. So what
Linda still makes fun
Welsh
of me.
Mean to you? Yeah.
Linda still makes fun of me because I was actually in a parking lot outside of her daughter's apartment. And I was worried that there was security, that I would be found out because what I was doing was kind of against the rules. And I just remember every time a car passed by, I saw the headlights and I thought, oh, they're going to discover me. It didn't help that I'd also just been bit in the leg by Linda's granddaughter's dog, but that's another story. So yeah, I didn't sleep very well. And I remember waking up the next morning because Linda was down walking the dog and she pounded on the side of the van. And I jumped up so fast that I thought I would hit my head on the ceiling. Just, you know, ready to have somebody kicking me out or, you know, just completely on edge. And obviously everything worked out fine, but I definitely felt the feelings that Bob so aptly described.
It's difficult. I mean, I would like everyone to understand that it's not really easy to live in a van. If you imagine that you're just to live in the country, walking across Europe in a van, no, it's not easy. You are afraid. You have to really take care of yourself, because if you don't take care of yourself, nobody does. So it's not easy. I was to forget, but since you talked about the van and the parking, I remember right now Quartz Site. This is quite a story. This is really a huge story about the history with a man from Syria who founded this town. So, I mean, I laughed a lot, really. Sorry.
But it's amazing. I mean, can I jump in and say, can you believe that this town exists, and it's actually not very far from Los Angeles, and it's that crazy.
That's why I laughed. I mean,
Hollywood had never been there before. I was like, how do you people not, do you know what I mean? It's just right in their backyard. And for me, it was so cinematic and interesting and crazy. And I'm, you know, I live in the Northeast, so I couldn't figure out how it hadn't made it onto the mainstream culture map somehow, because it's just an outrageous place.
Thank you. I mean, I love you very much. I love your book very, 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 very much. I recommend it. But I would like you in the end just to say a few words to the Romanian readers who actually are not used to this culture of the RVs, the van life, etc. But just an advice for them to understand your book as, I don't know, the story of an emotional story about people we usually do not understand.
Yeah, I think that even though the circumstances may be distinctly American, in terms of just, again, America is a very large country, our economic and social situations can be unique, that there are universal themes here, that on the other side of tragedy, people can come together and help each other out. And I think particularly now, with the world facing this pandemic, those are truths that it's really useful to hold close to our hearts. So I hope they come through to readers in Romania. And I'm just really thrilled that that you and other readers have come to care about these people as much as I did. That really touches me deeply. So thank you for the time you took with them, both reading the book twice and watching the movie twice.
Yes.
And I'll certainly tell that to them.
They will care about the readers. I mean, they will love the book. I am pretty sure. This is top journalism. And congratulations at the end. And thank you once again. And I don't know, just good luck with your projects in journalism. You're the best. I mean, really.
Thank you, Alita. It means a lot. All right, back at you.
Thank you.